Coming up on today's show.
I never had to go to those meetings to stop drinking. He took the desire right out of me. And I marvel at that today.
All of that and more on today's show.
Minister at Grace Cathedral, and this is my lovely wife, Kathy. On today's program, we have someone who's going to share his testimony, how God delivered him from alcohol, cigarettes, and marijuana.
Welcome to the show, Wid. We're so glad that you're with us today.
Glad to be here.
Now, your story starts in South Carolina, where you lived, correct?
Yes.
Okay, well, we want to know what happened.
Okay. 1979, I'm watching TV. Mm-hmm. I didn't know who Reverend Angeli was, but I watched the program, and at the end, I said to myself, wow, is this real? I had a good idea it was.
So you were seeing miracles and—
Yes.
And you wanted to know if they were real.
Yes. So in Crawler on the TV, I saw where he was coming to Charlotte. I got the time, jotted it down, and I asked my older brother if he would like to ride with me. He said, yeah. Now,
what was your life like at this time, point in time?
Okay, as we were going to see Reverend Angeli, I'm sorry to have to say this, but I had marijuana and beer in my car going to see the program. That's sad, but it's the truth. I was...
So you were drinking at
I was the time? Drinking. Mm-hmm. I was bad to drink.
Okay, so you were drinking as you were going to see Reverend Angeli.
That's a fact.
And you were smoking marijuana?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Now...
And that was pretty much your lifestyle.
That's the way I lived. I didn't think I could actually live without it. So I get to the building, and get in early, get good seats, and the Reverend comes out. And I was just tuned in. I mean, I had a pretty good idea that Reverend Angeli was the real deal.
Did you think you were saved or anything?
Oh, no.
Okay,
no. I knew I was a hit.
Okay.
I was a mess.
Okay.
I was...
Some people think they can smoke and drink and still be saved. So, but that wasn't the case with you.
Oh, Lord, no. I knew I was a snake.
Okay.
And I was really getting into the program. And I could tell that the program was about to wind down. And I became very, very sad to the point where I just hung my head down and I started praying, Lord, here I am. Lord, here I am. Now, my eyes are closed, my head is bowed. And I heard something. I heard Reverend Angeli talking. But I didn't open my eyes to look up. But he was saying, sir, stand up and come here. He repeated this 2-3 times, I guess. Finally, I just looked up, and he's looking in my direction. He said, sir, stand up and come here. I did that. He did that. I didn't move. I was scared.
So everybody was probably looking at you too.
Oh yes. Yeah, oh yes. He said that a time or two more, and I did that again. Come on down here. So I looked around and there was thousands of people looking at me, and I'm thinking, what am I gonna do? So I got up. And I made my way down, and I come across the platform. And I walked up to Reverend Angeli, and he just looked at me. And I didn't say a word. After a moment or two, he said, you've tried to kill yourself, haven't you? I didn't say nothing. He said twice. I said, oh, my. I never told nobody that. Nobody.
So that was true. You had tried to commit suicide twice in your
twice.
Life.
Twice. I never told no one. Mm-hmm. And I knew then that he was the real deal.
He's a man of God.
Oh, he's a true man of God. And I said, yes. He said, I'm looking into your soul and I'm seeing suicidal demons. Now, I thought he said seven. He might have meant several, but he said, do you want to be delivered? I said, I do. I knew I was in bad shape. So he touched me on the forehead, and all I remember was opening my eyes up, looking at the top of the auditorium, and I got up. And the strange thing, when he touched me, I know now it was the power of God, but it felt like to me that I went back on my back and shot across that platform. When I opened my eyes, I thought he was going to be way over there, but he was right there. I didn't go nowhere. That's just what it felt like. Mm-hmm. I didn't know anything.
The power of God was so great that you felt like it just propelled you across the room.
That's how it felt to mm-hmm. me. So I got up, he prayed for me, and I went home. Now,
what was your brother? Your brother was with you, right?
My brother was with me. So, I kind of got ahead of myself. When my head is bowed and my eyes are closed, Reverend says, sir, stand up. It was when my brother brushed up against my arm that I raised my head and I looked and I thought, oh my God, he's calling for my brother. Reverend Angel says, no, the one sitting beside you, stand up and come here.
That's when you knew it was you and not your brother.
I looked over and there's no one sitting on the other side of him. Mm-hmm. The only one sitting beside him was me. He said, come down here. After a while, I came down. Mm-hmm. But he picked me out of thousands of people because when I said, Lord, here I am, I knew it. I meant it.
Yeah, you were honest-hearted.
Right. Your heart was crying out to God. And I think that's, you know, when a soul that is in deep need, even though that they're not saved, sincerely cries out to God, God's going to hear that cry. And he heard your cry in that crusade amongst all those thousands of people.
He did. He did.
Well, what I was asking was when you got saved and, you know, you received your deliverance, what did your brother think of all this? He's watching you. I mean, you went back and you rode home with him. So did you guys talk? Did you say, you know, what went on?
It didn't take.
Okay.
It didn't take it.
Okay.
And, I just knew mm-hmm. that when he saw how I lived after mm-hmm. that it would take mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. because we got drunk together all the time. Mm-hmm. We smoked pot, drank,
right.
we partied together. He was mm-hmm. like Reverend Ainsley stood together. Mm-hmm. They
right.
stayed together.
Right.
Well, when he saw that I didn't no longer do any of that stuff, I knew that was going to draw him in, but it didn't. Uh-huh. It didn't take.
So it just changed your relationship with him.
Oh, yeah. I couldn't no longer do
right.
none of that stuff no more. And some time passed. I don't know. I can't remember how long it was, but I regret to say this, but I backslid on God. And I went right back into the stuff that I was doing.
Now, how did that happen, Wig? I mean, was that like you just all of a sudden, you know, was it a slow process or was it just you were tempted and you just gave over to those temptations?
I was married at the time, and it seemed that the wife and I got into a disagreement. Mm-hmm. And I wanted it at the end. Mm-hmm. And she said, Wid, I've got a joint. She opened a small cedar chest and said, let's smoke this and it'll be all right.
Hold that thought, because we need to take a quick break, and we'll be right back, and Wid's gonna let us know what happened.
COVID-19 has changed our lives. It's changed how we go shopping, how we interact with others, how we do business, how we help those in need. But we know that in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Even though things around us have changed, God's love is still the same. And as we distance ourselves from each other, we know that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. So let His love give you comfort and peace wherever you are. Join us as we stream live from Grace Cathedral every weekend.
Make plans to join us for our July 4th camp meeting weekend of services, July 3rd through 5th. Go to ErnestAngeley.org for all of the details. Come expecting God to move for you.
Our Grace family is moving to a new time. Watch every Sunday morning at 8, beginning July 5th, right here on this station. Experience life-changing miracles with Our Grace family every Sunday morning at 8.
We're back, and now, Wid, you had a decision to make. What were you going to do?
Yes, I made the wrong decision because I agreed, and
she was your wife had the box with the marijuana cigarette in it.
She took it out.
She was holding it.
And asked me if I would do it with her. I said yes. So we smoked it together.
And that's where you backslid.
That's where I backslid, and all that I was delivered from came right back up on me. The drinking, cigarettes. So I backslid completely on the Lord.
Did you try getting back, or you just said, you know, you just kept on going deeper and deeper into sin?
Deeper and deeper. And it was in 1998, 20 years had passed from when I had first saw Reverend Angeley and got delivered. So I'm watching TV in my apartment. It's 5 o'clock Sunday afternoon. I'm channel surfing, and Reverend Angeley's program came on.
And this is at your house, and you're all by yourself.
I'm by myself, and I'm glad I was, because I was free to let my emotions flow, and I did. I picked the remote up to turn it. I said, I'm not going to turn it. I'm going to watch this. So I reached over and I put the marijuana cigarette out, and I watched the program. Now, Reverend Angeley had an incredible salvation message, and the tears were hitting my chest like a hard rain. And it was at that time that Reverend offered the viewers to put their hand against his. I got up to do that. Halfway to the TV, I stopped. I said out loud, I can't do this, Lord. You got to help me. I guess that's what he wanted to hear, because I did put my hand against his on the TV, and I repeated the sinner's prayer. 24 hours later, about Monday afternoon, I'm getting ready to go to work. I got my uniform on, and I noticed that I had a pack of cigarettes in my shirt pocket. And I said, oh, I haven't smoked a cigarette all day. And then I thought, oh, I haven't smoked a cigarette since
salvation.
Salvation. You receive prayer.
Now, I was set free.
And you knew what that was like, because you had received that deliverance back in that crusade, and now you received deliverance again, so the Lord took you back.
He took me back, and He took the desire out of me for that. I never had to wear a patch to stop smoking. I never had to go to those meetings to stop drinking. He took the desire right out of me. And I marvel at that today, because when I see someone smoking, as I pass them on the road, I'm thinking, Lord, You took that from me. I thank You. Because when I said what I did with Reverend Ainsley's program, I'm in it. And the desire left me. The marijuana, the cigarettes, the beer, never touched my lips again. That's been decades. And people knew how I lived. Mm-hmm. I was a snake. My own family members hated me.
Mm-hmm. And that was before salvation.
Yes, because there was no good in me. There was no good in me at all.
Well, you know that was God that brought that program right to you.
Oh, yes. I know that's true.
Yeah, and you had a choice to make. You could either change the channel or watch it. But I believe the Holy Spirit was moving on you, just, you know, putting conviction on you, pouring it on you, and, you know, you realize that.
There's no doubt about that.
But what I think is amazing, Whit, and I think it's important for our viewers to understand, is that you can backslide on God. He gives us a power to live free from sin, but it's a choice.
Yeah.
You can go back into sin just like you chose to go back into sin by smoking that joint with your wife. And all that came back, all those addictions came back, mm-hmm. but the Lord took you back in.
He took me back in.
That's beautiful. Know that the Lord is married to the backslider, and He wants every backslider to come home. It's just like the prodigal son. You know, the Lord waited, you know, His father waited Him with open, you know, welcomed Him with open arms. And that's what Jesus mm-hmm. does. He welcomes us in open arms. And that's what He did with Wed.
Yes. I am so blessed. There's a famous ball player once said, I am the luckiest man on the face of the earth. I said, we don't recognize luck here, but we do recognize blessings. And I've been blessed so much. I'm so grateful to be here because of all the people on this earth. I'm at this ministry. I'm actually working for Reverend Ainsley. I am so blessed. Mm-hmm. I never will forget it. How good He's been to me.
So when did you make the decision to move to Ohio from South Carolina?
1998 is when I rededicated my life. It took me 2 years to get out of debt. I didn't want to leave anybody owing a dime. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I got up here in 2000. I'm ready to celebrate my 20th year very soon.
Well, we celebrate with you, Whit.
Yes, thank
We're
you.
So glad
yes.
you're with us.
I'm so glad to be here. I'd never get old. And if it does, I know I'll be in trouble if that gets old. Mm-hmm. I am so blessed to be here.
Well, do you want to tell us about how you received the baptism of the Holy Ghost?
Well, I saw it for years.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen people go down and get the Holy Ghost their first time. And I saw it for years.
So was that kind of discouraging to you?
Discouraging? I don't even touch it.
Okay.
I left there crying.
Mm-hmm.
I left there mad.
Mm-hmm.
That's the truth, not receiving. And I thought, my goodness, what's wrong with me? Am I a hypocrite? So I said, okay, I'll fast. If that's what it takes, I'll do a 40-day. I did a 40-day, still didn't receive. I did another one, and it wasn't that long, 6 or 8 months. I did another one and still didn't receive. I said to myself, do I have enough love to receive the Holy Ghost? And I was, I was desperate. So I went to the love chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I said, and I started getting in that. I said, well, I'll just rememberize the love chapter, if that's what it takes. Mm-hmm. And I looked and I saw, well, this is huge. I said, okay, if that's what it takes, I'll just start working on it. And memorized the love chapter. Mm-hmm. I still didn't receive the Holy Ghost. I said to myself, do I have the faith to receive the Holy Ghost baptism? So I heard that there was a faith chapter, mm-hmm. Hebrews 11, 40 verses. I said, Lord, I'll memorize this too, if that's what it takes for me to receive. That's 922 words. I memorized it from 1 to 40, from 40 back to 1, or at random. I said, okay, now, I got to receive now. I've got the love in my mind. I got the faith in my mind. And it still took a while after that. Reverend Ainsley told me, meet me behind the curtain after service. I said, okay. I get back there, and there was 12, 15 people back there helping me. And you was one of them.
Was that the night that you went all night?
All night, I think till 6:30 in the morning. Mm-hmm. Okay. I left there.
So you were seeking all night, praising God. Mm-hmm. He was praising God.
You were determined.
Yeah, and you still didn't receive.
I left devastated. Mm-hmm. I was wiped out. Mm-hmm. You encouraged me not to give up. I said, and I was trying to be polite, I was gone. Mm-hmm. I sought until my throat, it felt like I had a chicken egg stuck right there, wrapped around with sandpaper. I couldn't talk. Mm-hmm. My throat hurt me to swallow.
Yeah, I remember you had a hard time.
And while I was seeking the baptism, even Reverend Ainsley was right there in front of me. Mm-hmm. I would seek, and I would get so thirsty, and I was begging for water. Mm-hmm. He said, give him water. After a while, he said, don't give him no more water. Mm-hmm. I guess there was a reason for that. I stopped to kind of catch my breath, and Reverend Ainsley said, the Spirit is all around you. Mm-hmm. I said, what? He said, the Spirit is all around you. I see it. I said, sweet Jesus, it is. He started laughing. I never will forget it. Well, I saw it till the sun come up, and I left, and you walked me out the hallway. You was trying to help me. I was broken. I was devastated.
We have good altar workers, and they're all praising with you.
Oh, yeah.
And they stuck out with you. They stayed with you, you know? So there's a lot of love at this church, I'll tell you that.
That's for sure. So soon after that, Reverend Ainsley calls for the altar for those who would seek in the Holy Ghost. So my throat is hurting me so bad. And not only that, when I was seeking, I thought I pulled something loose. Mm-hmm. Maybe I had a hernia or something, because I'm hurting so bad in my ribs. So I thought, okay, I'll go down and I'll seek for a few minutes. I'm going home. I'm hurting here, I'm hurting here. I go down and I close my eyes and I'm start seeking, and I sought the Holy Ghost so long that I know who's around me by their voice. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, okay, that's her. Yeah, that's him, that's her. I knew who they were. And I'm seeking, and the people around me are so excited. Their breath is moving my hair. I won't forget that. And all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost starts to speak. Mm-hmm. And I'm listening to him. I can't hardly believe it. Mm-hmm. He's speaking, and I'm thinking, I hear this. Mm-hmm. That's me, but that's him.
In another language.
Another language. Mm-hmm. I was so happy.
I think everybody around you was really happy too. I mean, it's just, you know, when you help someone seek for so long, you know, and I think it was pretty long, wasn't it, Wynn? You know, like many years.
10 years.
10 years. When you're helping someone seek for 10 years, when they receive, you're just right up there with them.
I go to the altar afterwards and I start crying. Mm-hmm. I'm not one to show emotion, especially crying. Mm-hmm. I couldn't help it. All of a sudden I start laughing. I couldn't help that. Mm-hmm. And went back and forth. Mm-hmm. And I reasoned within myself. I said, that was God. That was God doing that.
Holy mm-hmm. Spirit.
And
well, it's a very humbling experience when you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but it's a very exciting experience.
Yes.
And I'd like to encourage everybody, if you do not have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, come and receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, because it's very, very yes. important to have it in this final hour. God is moving for this Jesus ministry, and we're touching souls.
Yes.
So this was a wonderful testimony, Wynn, and you know, it's great how you gave it, and what a huge blessing. So stay with us, because we'll be right back.
Our Grace family is moving to a new time. Watch every Sunday morning at 8, beginning July 5th, right here on this station. Experience life-changing miracles with Our Grace family, every Sunday morning at 8.
Miracles are real. I was delivered from leukemia over 28 years ago.
Miracles are real. I was healed of cancer over 17 years ago.
Miracles are real. I know because I received one for ovarian cancer in 1996.
Friend, don't doubt God. His miracles are so real. The Bible says the things that are impossible with men are possible with God. So come and be with us in our Friday night miracle service and receive your miracle.
Plans to join us for our July 4th camp meeting weekend of services, July 3rd through 5th. Go to ErnestAngeley.org for all of the details. Come expecting God to move for you.
Our Grace family is moving to a new time. Watch every Sunday morning at 8, beginning July 5th, right here on this station. Experience life-changing miracles with Our Grace family, every Sunday morning at 8.
If you are enjoying today's program, let us know by sending in a donation. Your gift of love will enable others to be lifted up into the grace of God.
Wonderful show, and I just love how Wid's testimony, how he got delivered and set free from all those bondages.
Yes, and how he was determined to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, and I just think that, you know, God was moving in such a glorious way for Wid, and he's blessed. And I pray that this show blessed you in a wonderful way.
Well, we have a new time next week. Our show is moving to 8 o'clock, so make sure you tune in then. Hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.
If this program has blessed you today, let us know on our Facebook page. You're also invited to attend any of our services. Come and witness the wonderful things of heaven for yourself. This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Ernest Angeley Ministries.